Leaving with you?
Yeah, I thought about it.
Why are you tripping? You ain't doing jack shit here. King, why don't you just come with me?
Ain't nothing gonna change in Atlanta. I mean, I'm still gonna be black. Just another nigga from the ghetto.
Why do you say stupid shit like that?
Cause it's true. I mean, you act like Atlanta ain't in America. They don't give a fuck.
You know what? You know what Anthony asked me the other night? He asked me if you were gonna die. If you were gonna die, Cave. Are you gonna come with us or not?
I thought Michael says the police hate black people.
Well, no. That's not true. That's not true at all. Some
no.
of us.
Is Cave gonna die?
Ain't nothing gonna change in Atlanta. I mean, I'm still gonna be black. Just another nigga from the ghetto.
Take. Bye. Take your time. Take your time. Take your time. Take your breath.
Space. My mom always told me, you better make that fucking money. Wherever it is.
I'll be looking for it.
Hope y'all still with me. Thanks for taking on this journey.
CT needed more than any of us. Look, she didn't do anything. She walked out.
But fuck cares? She's dead.
Oh, fuck that. She didn't do nothing, so she ain't getting nothing.
Get it? Frankie, I don't want your money. Now, if you want to kick my ass, then come on, let's just get it over with, because I am sick of your shit. I need that money.
As we proceed, forget you what she needs.
Come to Mama's house, because he only trusted my mother. Right, so all his dirt that he did, Mama knew everything. But he had these three boosters. They would come, and then they'd come one at a time in. And they would take, one would have all meat, strapped all around. She would have a girdle from here to her knees. And the meat was stuck in every part of the gate girdle. Come to Mama's house, because he only trusted my mother. Right, so all his dirt that he did, Mama knew everything. But he had these three boosters. They would come, and then they'd come one at a time in. And they would take, one would have all meat, strapped all around. She would have a girdle from here to her knees. And the meat was stuck in every part of the gate girdle. And the first stop he would make was my mother's house. Take what you need, Bart. Take what you need. Bart, go shop. Suits. Remember when they had those bush jacket suits? Sand, polyester, bush jackets.
Take your time.
My mother was working at the bank. She had every color suit. Because they'd come to my mother's house first.
Did she have to buy them?
No. She counted his money.
Oh.
That was a pay. She counted the money.
Sounds all a bit crooked.
So big. My daddy was a little man. And he would just, I don't know how he did it. How many would you got? How many suits you got? Huh? And they, like, it was almost like pimping. I don't know what it was.
You know, sounds like that was the case.
I need to get my daughter needs some this, my children need some this. They come to mom's house and do the inventory.
And they got along with grandma too?
But my mother was, you know, mama was hard. Mama was hard.
I didn't know that. I didn't see that side of her.
Mama was like, Kelsey got a little mama. Mama was that kind of person, like, just really sweet, everybody loved her.
Oh, sharing your heart.
But the reason she didn't like him there is because he would lay down on the couch. He was a small little room. Come on, go take a shower. I'm in the room and draw.
Nix Seraph.
You have been identified as a maverick for violating Dora law.
Nix Seraph.
You have been identified as a maverick for violating Dora law. Therefore, your detainment reflects your crimes. Nix Seraph. You have been identified as a maverick for violating Dora law. Therefore, your detainment reflects your crimes, including vandalism, desecration of Jod's holy relic, the monolith, and attempting to sway Jod belief. You are hereby sentenced to immediate repurposing under code XJ88. This is not a punishment, but an improvement to your cognitive decision-making. You will leave a believer and a true walker of the Jod path. Please remain still.
Please remain still. Please remain still.
Essence. form, being, shaping being, thought, shaping thought, destiny, shaping destiny. We are not born with limitless potential, but with predefined paths. Essence, form, being, shaping being, thought, shaping thought, destiny, shaping destiny. We are not born with limitless potential, but with predefined paths. Essence, form, being, shaping being, thought, shaping thought, destiny, shaping destiny. Thank you.
it would be a nice way to kind of just start off the first of our programs related to Infinite Rehearsal, with having two of the artists in this show, Cody and Qwenga, share not only the work that they are and will continue to workshop, but maybe to share a little bit. Cody's work is an invitation to breathe and for breath, and I feel like we can do that together. But maybe to have each of you share a little bit about what you shared with us tonight and how you have been and are going to be using this space for the show.
Hi everyone, I'm Cody. Algorithm Code, I have a group called the Algorythms since 2008. What you saw tonight was an excerpt. I'm like obviously in rehearsal, but I've been performing a lot lately, for recently more than ever. And so I have a repertory of songs that I'm in rotation, but this specific one, I've just been so tired because I'm in school full time. And I've been needing to take a break. And I feel like the only way I connect with my family, in particular my mother and my sister, is through work. And it made me think about how we live in a society where like the only way I connect and I feel like I'm fulfilling what my mom wants me to do is if I'm constantly working. But I want it to be through relaxation and taking breaths and taking time. Like during the pandemic, I saw her doing yoga. I had videos of my sister and her son doing yoga, and now that the world has started, my sister's driving trucks. So she drives 6 days a week. Her son is now by himself with my parents. My mom is always traveling, so like, that was kind of like my message to them, is just like, take the time to take a breath. Like, and I wanted to force everybody to take a moment for themselves through my music to like, I don't know where it took you, because I know it's kind of loud. I know I'm loud, but like, I wanted you guys to like, you know, go somewhere with me. I don't know where, but you know. So yeah.
We did.
So Monolith started as this idea that came about after I read Octavia Butler's Pattern Master and Parable of the Talents and Parable of the Sower. And then after I watched 2001 Space Odyssey, the whole like 2-3 hours, I was like, there's something like interesting about monoliths and like how people either connect to them or like repulsed by them, and how they have like some sort of like non-physical control over us, or non-physical like connection to us, specifically like people of color. I know there's this thing of like people of color, like not monolithic, so that kind of tied into monolith. But the story of monolith is there's this 1% of people, they're called the Jaud, J-A-U-D, and they build this giant rock-like monolith, and they built it to control the 90% of the population, which are called, I'm sorry, the 1% is called Dora, the 90% is called the Jaud, but there's like 9% of people who are called the Mavericks, and they can all communicate telepathically. The only issue is that they are separate and they have different egos about the monolith and about the 90%. Some of them care, some of them don't. Some of them want to destroy the monolith, and some of them want to reveal the secrets, like, oh, this is just a monolith, you guys don't have to worship this thing to get, you know, to Nirvana or heaven. So 90% of people are like worshiping this monolith. And one maverick, his name is Nix Seraph, he leaves his lair, goes to the monolith, and tries to start taking pieces of it to show the 90%, like, look, it's just a rock. Mm-hmm. He gets caught by the door, the 1%, and placed into an isolation type chamber where they are repurposing him and trying to convert him back into a Jaud before he wakes everyone up. So he gets repurposed back into a Jaud, and he's like, you know, that's why it was a lot of like repetitive movement and like prayers, because they're just worshiping people and worshiping like a false, you know, image or false thing. But towards the end, he kind of like snaps out of it, and then tries to use his, like, you know, gracefulness and his maverick-like tendencies. The door catch on, knock him back out. So the story is, like, very expansive. My guy Elliot right here, he's done, like, all the VFX, the green flies you guys have. He did all the artwork for that. And me and him just, like, get on FaceTime and talk about Monolith, like, for hours. Like, for real. We're like, he's like, I'm like, what do you think about a maverick getting drunk and then coming to the city and being like, yo, I don't care no more, give me some liquor. And then, like, he'll just go on and on. So we've just been writing about it. And we want to turn it into a novel, we want to turn it into a movie. It's, like, just so expensive. But this is just, like, a small portion of it. So, yeah, that's Monolith. And it ties into, like, a lot of cultural references and a lot of, like, historic references. Sorry. A lot of historic references that we were, like, Papa was a Rolling Stone because it's a rock. This is, like, so many other references that we were tying into. And it just all boils down to, like, the power is within. It's not, you know, some thing outside. Mm-hmm. So,
wow. Is it something, Qwenga, that, like, you're with the Monolith, is it something you're going to come, you know, in your, specifically in your time here at ICLA, like, develop new chapters or, you know, stay in it with Nick Sarah?
No, I want to, like, tap into, like, the other Mavericks. Mm-hmm. Like, we've been, me and Ellie have been talking about, like, other Mavericks and, like, there's a kid in the story now who, like, is going around the city, and he, like, goes to the Monolith and he's, like, decoding the symbols on it, and he'll, like, run around the town with the symbols. So it's, like, so many characters to get intimate with and that's what I'm using my time group for. So now it's Nick Sarah, next is, I haven't got a name for him yet, but he's a drunk. Yeah. That one, he won't get caught and punished because he just kind of conforms and is drinking. Yeah, they have, like, self-realization. Running into this kid, like, oh, this kid is actually trying to do something. Let me, like, tap in with him, you know?
Yeah.
But I don't want to go, like, Nick Sarah route and get tore up and, like, just
be, see what happens. We already saw what happened there.
Yeah. So he heard through the telepathy. He's like, oh, something's going on with Nick. Like, Nick's, he's getting beat, so, yeah.
Cool. I feel like that's also, you know, I love that, like, in the pairing that Chris did of these, of you two together, of, like, thinking about how, you know, the power is held within, and also, like, for your work, Cody, of, like, really taking us back into our bodies as listeners and folks experiencing what you've created. So I feel like two very different approaches to that, kind of what it means to be in your body, what it means to be a body, that's also, you know, changed to certain forms of power and structures of power that control not only, like, bodies but also, like, mind and memories and, like, work. Like, capitalism is this form of just, like, also just connection. So how do you, like, turn that into a place of connection too?
I was about to say, I was, like, tying it into, like, we had talked and we're like, I was like, yo, every time somebody try to, like, go against the grain, they get, like, so they get, like, made an example out of. So that we were like, that was, like, another reference point for sure. Mm-hmm. It just came to my mind.
I feel like, you know, part of the intention for this first program is also not only to share your work and these works in process, but also to share a little bit about the ideas behind this exhibition. So I'd love Cody and Qwenga here, if you're comfortable staying up here, because Chris and I are going to chat a little bit about that, but also to kind of weigh in from your own perspective of what it has been so far in our first couple weeks of the show, and then, of course, you know, we're in a super nice intimate setting where hopefully, you know, some, we can start fielding some questions from you too. But maybe just to kick it off, Chris Emile, an amazing artist, choreographer, dancer in his own right. I feel so grateful. For those who don't know me, I'm Amanda. I'm the senior curator here at ICALA. I feel so deeply grateful to Chris for saying yes to working together on kind of conceiving Infinite Rehearsal and to bringing not only your work and your presence and your spirit and your light to this space and to the ideas behind it, but also that of six other artists who work with you as part of No One Art House. So maybe to start off, maybe Chris, you can share a little bit about kind of the genesis of this show. We can talk to you about it together.
Yeah. Thank you first. Yeah. Thank all y'all for being here. To go back a little bit, No One Art House is kind of a collective that I started with my friend Sabrina over here.
Sabrina!
And two other folks who are no longer over here. They're on the way. And yeah, it was just kind of an idea that we all had of just wanting to bring, we all come from dance, from concert dance, and just wanting to make that more accessible in LA, because it can be quite elitist and like very separatist. And like once I kind of moved into fine art world, I just saw like, oh, other mediums of art are way more inclusive and kind of bring other people along. So we just were trying to find that, and so we started working in like experimental spaces and gallery spaces and museum spaces. So that's kind of how we got here to this day. And it's, yeah, it's really monumental what like Amanda and what the ICLA has done. Like this floor that you all are on is called a proper sprung dance floor. It's just like wooden squares with nothing in the middle and then a platform on top of it, so that like when you jump, there's like a little bit of give. And yeah, it's for dancers to just be able to save their joints and to just be able to be safe. And that only exists in dance studios. Like every time that you see a performer outside of a dance studio, they're on concrete. And it's really hard on the muscles, you know? So that was kind of the first step for this, of just being like, can y'all build the floor if we're gonna be here for 4 months? And they agreed. So it's just really monumental what the ICA is doing on that level. And then the idea of just rehearsal, you know, like when every day when the museum is open, other, also there are two other artists here, part of the show, Jovel and Shana. Yeah, when you come to the museum, you'll just be witnessing them rehearsing, not performing for you, not like pretending to be like some weird person at the museum, but truly just in their own process doing what they would do in, at their home, in a dance studio or whatever. So that's also very like monumental for us as movement artists to be able to have this platform to work and not have to produce anything necessarily and have people witness and just see you on the scale in this institution. So yeah, there's No One Art House is also in residence at the Ace Hotel in Palm Springs. So Qwenga is currently in residence there right now. Cody was just there. Shauna will be there in the spring. So it's really just like an opportunity for them to keep like flushing out things that they want to make. And it's rare that artists get that time and space to do that. So, yeah.
And we thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah.
It's so expensive. Like, for me, even if I was to go into a recording studio or something, or just even being at my house, like I have a setup and stuff, it's not, it's different being in a room where I can like play with my delivery and hear how my voice resonates in the speakers and just like not be charged by hour. And if I want to, like I can, like I have a dance background, I grew up dancing with Chris, things changed. But now that I'm in the space, I'm like feeling like, y'all saw me, I was in the corner, but like, I wanna move like with my piece. So like, what you caught was the beginning stages, and who knows where we'll be 4 months from now, thanks to this space and thanks to ICA, LA.
Yeah, that's awesome. I feel like there was also, you know, a lot of the, like, my own background, a lot of my background and focus was in performance, but also coming from different types of institutions that I think as, I said this a couple times before, but I feel like institutions, at least art museums and art institutions, have like figured out, pretty much have figured out how to care for objects or more traditional art mediums, be it painting, sculpture, works on paper. But we still haven't quite figured out how to like care for the living, be it like, you know, in the context of performance, but also caring for the living in terms of staff and how we, you know, model that. So I feel like in talking with Chris, who I moved to LA just over a year ago, and Chris was one of the artists, one of like the first artists working in movement who I saw or like had seen some work of, and was really excited by it. And actually like a year ago today, as part of LA, or like a year ago, 2 days from now, as part of the LAX Festival, JoBell and Cody were performing together, it came up on my memories of my phone. Like, y'all performing together, like this is so crazy and beautiful to get this chance to like do that here. Yeah, it was here. But I feel like that idea of like through an exhibition using the resources that we would ordinarily, you know, if you've come to visit the space at ICLA before, the project room is always a space of experimentation, often supporting artists and making their, you know, having their first museum exhibition, as was the case of the last artist, or pushing their practice in a way they haven't before, which is kind of, you know, the overall spirit of ICALA. But with this, it was like, okay, how can we really think about like the, even just like the funds we would ordinarily put towards a 4-month exhibition to then reallocate that and redistribute that to various artists to be here with us, kind of building and making over the course of 4 months. And I feel like that's also like there's so much that comes with that. With each of the artists, it is also a negotiation, because being in rehearsal here is like having the space and having, you know, the space and time to do that, but it's also then like engaging with our visitors in a certain capacity, or, you know, and we'll see how that unfolds over the course of the next 4 months, of like some rehearsals will be closed, or some will be, you know, there will be certain kind of ways in which we have to think through that with our visitors and with each other. But I feel like that's also like very vulnerable for you all to be, even like a program like this where we're sharing a glimpse of a work in process, to be like, yeah, like you can, you know, that's like, yeah, part of the contract, I guess, is like that negotiating.
It's been pretty crazy, because like I was rehearsing like a couple days ago, and somebody came with their dog. And I was like, it was just crazy. Like, I come from street dance background, so like you see people walking everywhere, but like in here it was like, oh, this is like a space where there's like walls and lights and AC, and then somebody just came in with a dog and they were just like, I was like, hey. Like, yeah. So it's like a whole different experience, but like it's cool, because you know, people get to come into your world.
My rehearsal, I sound like shit. I be sounding like crazy. But I get to work it out, and people, my first day, people were walking by, and I'm yelling on the mic. And it's like, okay. And they're like, is he in there? What's happening? It's really interesting experience. It's like, kind of keeps you on top of your shit, too. Like, but like, still with the space to like figure it out, but like, you know, people are watching. Little bad notes resonating. My Instagram is on there. Like, she saw it. Like, this is crazy. Yeah, but it's really cool.
I feel like there was also this really great moment of Shauna's first rehearsal, or like, you know, your rehearsal last week here. We were talking, and it was like, it's also like kind of making visible the various ways, like what it means to be an artist. And like, you were working on a grant application. You're like, that's, I'm gonna use the space and time that I have right here and right now to do that. And I was like, that is so amazing, because it's also like, in being with, you know, regardless of what kind of artist you are, that's a huge part of the practice and the process, is like, you know, working on those grants, getting that kind of, you know, and having the space to do it, the time to do it. And so I feel like that also just shows the kind of range of ways in which, as artists, hopefully you'll all be engaging this space and thinking about it. I know, you know, Chris, for you, you did a workshop on our, as part of our open house, without audio, which is amazing. But hosting that and thinking of also, like, you know, both, like, how this can be a space for workshops and the ways in which, you know, like, you can invite folks in, or, like, this kind of helps in a period, too, where post-pandemic, like, a lot of artists lost their studios, a lot of artists working in movement lost their dance studios, or just it went, you know, the hourly price to rent from a studio went up, and so how this can be maybe, you know, in the window that we have in these 4 months to use it. And then maybe, you know, something to share, too, is the kind of, or like the aspect of this show conceptually that I feel like we were able to really talk through and work through, Chris, is also like not just the literal ways of like this is a space of rehearsal, But the ways in which, like, the even the title of the show itself comes from this, comes from a book called The Infinite Rehearsal, and it's by Wilson Harris, who's a writer, poet from Guyana. And it was written in 1988, and it was really a kind of, you know, it's this like speculative reflection on like the British imperialism in Guyana and the slave ships that were either brought there or taken extracted from Guyana during that period. But it's this like, yeah, this in the book, it's about these kind of the ghosts that perform on these ships. And I feel like there's a way in which with this exhibition, the idea of infinite rehearsal is also about the kind of the infinite rehearsals that we, as people, as bodies, are part of every day. It's a the constant performance of every day and ways in which that comes in. And so how this show kind of like makes that visible. I don't know, Chris, you want to like chat, but yeah, share more about that.
Absolutely. I was talking with Shauna a little bit after her first day, and she was like, yeah, someone came into the room and I automatically felt like, oh, do I have to put on for them, you know? And it's, there is that. We have that every day, especially as people of color, you know, like there is a mask. There is like this thing that sometimes we feel we have to change into, to appease and to get further in our life. So I think, you know, I think Shauna in that moment took that second to kind of like come back and be like, no, like this is my space. Like if you're coming in, like you're coming into my space, I'm not coming into yours. So yeah, but it is work. That is the rehearsal as well, to like be yourself, you know, no matter what. No matter what, which is hard. And there's a lot of unlearning. I don't know if you guys have experienced that here or even when it's like, I wanted to ask you what it's, because Cody, like you said, has been doing some work at the hotel, and also he just did something at Craft Contemporary, and, you know, Qwenga comes from street dance as well, but also works in, like, the commercial world, but, like, I don't know, getting to see Cody's work here versus these other spaces, like, what it's like to view it or to be viewed in the museum space, and, like, what it does to the audience, what it does to your work, like, maybe you guys can speak to that a little bit.
For me, what I felt tonight, I feel like when I say I'm like doing a show, I feel like I get really nervous, and I was nervous tonight. But then once it started, once I was in here before everybody even started, I was just like, fuck it, like I'ma just clear my energy, and everybody was really receptive, but not like my other shows, everyone was like, yeah. And everyone was really respectful and willing to go. I don't know it felt like everybody was willing to go with me, you know, and like, I feel like when you come into a museum or gallery, I feel like your mind is just like more receptive to a lot of different things. So instead of like feeling like you're coming to see a show, y'all were just here with me in rehearsal.
Yeah.
You know, it felt good. Hearing the response after I was done, because y'all saw me, I was like this in the corner. After the set, I was like, and then you guys were like, woo! I was like, oh! Y'all felt it, so it felt good. Like, my dance teacher used to say every show is like 10 dance classes, and I really feel like tonight I grew a lot as far as like where I'm going. So it was valuable.
Like attribute everything to like my upbringing and the dance crump. A lot of people make fun of it, but there's like a lot of lessons that you learn when it comes to like being yourself and like presenting something or sharing something. It's because like when you're in like a crump environment, it's literally like this. There's a circle, sometimes it's really small, sometimes it's even smaller. Like the circle will be this big, like where I'm standing, and you have to like get off and like share what you have, and like this person's screaming at you, this person's screaming at you, that person doesn't like you, this person doesn't like you, and like the person across from you like wants to bow to you too. So it's like all these things are happening, and then there's like music blaring, and you have to like try to catch the music too. So crump really prepared me for like any environment. It's really crazy. I can just be in like any space and just be like, oh, you know, I'm gonna share some work. This is a nice museum. Like, it's like, yeah, a lot of my confidence comes from street dance.
Right.
You had just gotten back from Palm Springs and like came right here, and then like we were like, okay, let's like rehearse for the rehearsal for the thing, for the rehearsal, and like let's run through it. And it was like amazing, this, because your work, the monolith piece, is so narrative. Like, you just became that character, and that ability to kind of like jump in and do that with your body in the state of like, I don't know, if I just got back trip and like, yeah. Or, you know, it just was like, yeah, I feel like you see that ability that you have.
Yeah, and Crump, like, if you're going to a session or like, you know, a dance session, and you pull up and somebody's waiting for you to come, as soon as you walk up, it's time to dance. So it's like, it's like, you just gotta be ready to hop out the car and get going. Like, do a couple stretches and like, get straight to it. Right. You know?
One of the things I wanted to also share within like the context of this is, beyond the conversations with Chris and like really wanting to realize a show like this, was that some of you who arrived early might have seen what's on You and Our Main Galleries, which is an exhibition dedicated to the work of Barbara T. Smith, who's an artist who was really a pioneer of performance art in Southern California, but from the background of kind of more a conceptual art practice approach to performance. And so the show is really a survey of the last six decades of Barbara's life. She turned 92 over the summer. One of the kind of ideas behind that show was organized by Janelle Porter, a guest curator based here in LA, is amazing. And one of the ideas was like, okay, what can we could either like have the show take over the project room, which is fine, or like, what would it look like to kind of like cast a lens and a light on what is happening in performance and movement today. An artist who was like such a pioneer, for her time, to then say like, who are the artists who are like, you know, really making waves with when it comes to movement and performance art practice today. So it feels like such a gift to get to also like be celebrating that and to be talking about, like, to your point, Chris, of like the spaces in which performance is presented, or like, you know, our institutions are more comfortable with presenting work like Barbara T. Smith's because it comes within a certain lineage of art history, like a very Western lineage of art history. But then like, there are ways in which dance or filmmaking or music has been siloed from these art spaces too. So I love that like through the seven artists who are here with us in rehearsal, it gets pulling all of those practices into the museum context in a way that hopefully, you know, we also grow as an institution. But because we have you all here too, I really want to create space and the chance to for you to ask questions as our audience, or just offer reflections for tonight for Cody and Qwenga, and also to Chris and I. So maybe this is a good chance to pivot to that. We have it. Yes.
Hello, everybody. So my name is Chris, and I just want to say, Cody, gratitude to you for taking us on a wild ride. At times, as artists, we are expecting that performance moved up to a show. And so me, when I sat down, I thought we were supposed to just watch what's on the screen. But then when it fizzled away and it went to a portal, it was like, oh, okay. So I do like that we were able to reflect and go here, there, and everywhere. You know, sometimes as people, we don't get to connect and just sit down and just sit. And so I just want to say thank you for that. Also, Qwenga, I'm a crumper as well. You are. You know, I support you. Being a crumper and taking the role as travel is very important, especially for our culture. And so I want to say gratitude to you, because you're not battling right now. You're not in our realm where we're used to the sessions being super hype, super loud, super egotistical. And so just to see you create the space with intention for yourself, with the influence of Crump, I commend you, brother. So this was beautiful, by the way. As artists, sometimes we always pinpoint our success or pinpoint this, but I love this space and this program, reality, because it's in reality, it's a continuum, you know? So I just want to say thank you for providing this space for artists and just artists like myself to be inspired by the space, people, and just everybody.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hey y'all, Frederick here. I'm a big fan of No One Art House, by the way, for many years. So keep on doing what you're doing. I really love this concept, man. It's really groundbreaking. So bravo to you, Curtis, and the whole team. And I love the whole idea of like, there's no pressure to create anything. Just come and be and allow yourself to flow. And at the same time, I'm curious if there so happens to be something that does come out of this. How is ICA planning to be in conversation with the works that do land as a result of this form of residency?
I mean, I think that, you know, like the, yeah, there is no expectation on the ICLA side of even like finality, which is, you know, like a final performance, a final program. I think like these public programs, and we'll do a public program with each artist over the course of the show to create like a little bit more public experience of a work in process. But I feel like, you know, the ways that we're supporting what happens next is right here, right now. And we would love, I mean, you know, we always love with every, ICLA has this like great history as a museum of firsts. And so for so many artists, it's like I was sharing about the project room, but like for so many artists, it's their first museum exhibition, first show in LA, first show in the US, et cetera. And so for us to be able, we then go on and get to celebrate the amazing, you know, seconds, thirds, fourths for those artists. And I see this as like, yeah, the beginning of a relationship with these artists and with their work and with their practice. I know with Chris, like Chris had done a public program with us here at ICLA before my time, but I know Oscar and Chris got to work together on that. And so, you know, this is like, this is the second for you and ICLA, a chance to like not only invite them to perform, but to like organize and create and curate. And so I feel like that's where, you know, where those firsts are that then leads to so much more. But I would say we don't have an expectation of anything beyond that.
Week by week is like a new, like the fact that we're here every week for 3 hours, that's like for 4 months, it's like, that's a lot of work that's already, you know, and it's valuable. So that as artists that we're taking away, is like, even if we're setting up cameras to film what we're making in here, it's very valuable for us. Even if at the end of the 4 months we don't even come back, what the time that we're spending here is very, very, very important. Like, I wouldn't be doing this shit if I was at home. Like, I would.
We hold you accountable.
Yeah, it's like, okay, I have to show up and I have to do something. So I'm gonna just use these speakers and go off, you know? And get my dance on, get my movement on, do my homework.
Yeah.
I've been to school full time.
Those firsts are a big deal. Like, even jumping from public performance to curatorial is a big deal for movement artists. Like, it's not easy to get your name on the wall. Like, for real. It's, I think this is my first time, like, with it like that, so.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Okay.
That public program was before COVID. It was like in 2019, 2018 or something, you know? So it's like, really, like, it takes time and it's worth it, you know? Like, it's important that spaces like this give those opportunities, you know? And we see it in other spaces, like with Kanye West or something. If he touches somebody, it's like, they're the big person, you know? Just giving that person that one chance is like a big deal to spark.
And I have to say too, with, and then go to somebody else, but I just also want to acknowledge in this moment of like how we create a space like this, both like in the literal building of it, but also in like holding a space for this. I know we have that three of our staff members are here, Tanya and Oscar, who are in our learning and engagement Woo! Department. Amazing. Zach is Zach. But I would say it does really take that, you know, it's also in the ideas that like curatorial we have, it's also like asking, we're a teeny team at ICALA, so it's also asking everybody to be in on this journey of like, there's a little bit unknown, there's a little bit of like, every day might be a new thing, or it's like sending a note on Slack like, hey, it's gonna be really loud today, or hey, we're not sure. And so I think that also takes like a certain like grace and trust with the staff too. So I just, before the end of the night, wanted to acknowledge that because that's a big part on the back end too.
Actually, this is a question for Cody. I was really interested in your note about movement and wanting to move more in your practice, and also thinking about your use of projection and kind of the capacity for synthesis of those mediums. And I wanted to know, like, what your kind of visioning of the projection was. I know it's a
So, I think, so the jellyfish are very peaceful and aggressive at the same time, and that's me, and like my lineage is like, I have my sister doing yoga, my sister is crazy hell, and she is the duality that lives in my bloodline that's just like hella aggressive, but like we're cool, but like, you know, just like a jellyfish. And I wanted to take a trip, and on those trips, that the beginning trees, that was my, I was driving from Atlanta to Miami with my family, like all five of us. We have not been in a car in close proximity together in years before COVID. So like, and my, to see my sister do yoga, it was just like, but it was so good. So like, I'm trying to bring all those things together, because I've been in the music industry and working as a songwriter producer for so long, where I'm creating these fake scenarios, and I'm, through the practice, I'm trying to tap into things that are like very organic to me, and like trying to find the purest form of self through. I made that projection today, like I make these, I produce all that music, like it's all coming together. And as a mover, I started off as a dancer growing up, crumping, clowning, and doing modern ballet dance, everything. But being in the space kind of makes me want to tap back into it. I don't know how it's going to look. I might be crawling, I might be sleeping on the middle floor. But I'm figuring it out.
I have a reflection to both of you. Cody, it immediately felt sacred when I came into the space listening to you tell us to take our time and to take a breath. Especially with that image of the trees passing by. I'm from South Georgia. Okay. So it felt like I was being invited into a spiritual space. That particular image is one that I would see driving down to my grandmother's church. It'd just be lines of pine trees. And so it felt like invitation into the spiritual journey of the space, and when I looked around, I could see everyone else in their own journey as well. So,
well, you get it.
So, thank you so much for that soundscape. Qwenga, as a person completely obsessed with sci-fi and the roles of Octavia and N.K. Jemisin, it was astounding and exciting to see your narration translated through movement. So, thank you so much for that.
With that, we thank you. Thank you all for being here, for being with us. Thank you so much. I hope that you'll come back. We have, like I said, two other programs, one in November, one in December, a chance to see some of these other artists, or just join us during the week to witness one of these rehearsals. So thanks for sharing space with us tonight and your reflections and your words. Thank you to Chris.
Yeah.
for being on this journey. Thank you, Cody. Thank you, Qwenga. And thank you, Joe Valentine, for coming up too. So we'll have the chance to chat a little bit, and then maybe we can just all move to the lobby. And we'll have to be out of here around 9. We might.